The 70-year-old American bomber was so unreliable and problematic that sometimes pieces of it would just fall off. It even dropped nuclear bombs on American soil, accidentally. In case you haven't figured it out yet, you need to wear a gas mask when 8 of this bomber's engines are starting up after using explosive charges. But more importantly, when it comes to bombing adversaries, if they have air defenses, this bomber is obsolete and has been for decades. But why the B-52 is expected to outlive much newer B-1 and stealthier B-2 bombers is the super-duper missile and a whole lot of luck. Seriously.
We have, I call it the super-duper missile.
You heard it right, a super-duper missile. That's what President Trump called it. The missile at hand is the AGM-183 hypersonic missile that is currently in development. But as of yet, it's not really that super-duper. Quite the opposite, actually. The missile failed to launch during its first 2 tests, but on May 14, 2022, it finally did. Third time's a charm, but what is not a charm is B-52's nickname. Commonly referred to as BUF, which stands for Big Ugly Fat F***, the B-52 Stratofortress was truly a F*** during its first few decades of service. The list of things that went wrong with the B-52 is as long as its age. Engine malfunctions, hydraulics failures, ice buildups, fuel leaks, metal fatigue, and structural failure, just to name a few. At least 2 dozen bombers were lost due to accidents outside of the combat zone, and even more were lost during combat. It kind of makes sense why BUF is equipped with multiple ejection seats. During its early years, BUF was like today's F-35, but probably worse if you take into account the multiple nuclear accidents. But today, the big ugly fat fucker is more of a fella, thanks to persistence of the US Air Force to make this airplane nearly perfect. The idea of the B-52 was conceived right after World War II in 1945, and the contract to build it was signed the year after, with its first flight taking place on April 15, 1952. In total, 742 aircraft of 8 different versions were produced. During the 1950s and 60s, B-52 bombers were the principal instrument of the United States Air Force to obliterate the Soviet Union with nuclear bombs, if needed. Operation Chrome Dome was a Cold War doomsday program that kept a dozen B-52 bombers in the air 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, for 8 years. The bombers flew outside of the Soviet Union's borders to provide rapid first strike or retaliation capability in case of a nuclear war. Chrome Dome started in 1960, and B-52s flew multiple routes over Alaska, Greenland, and Spain with the help of aerial refueling. But it was during this operation that B-52s earned the second F in their nickname, when they crashed 5 times with nuclear weapons on board. On January 24, 1961, 12 miles north of Goldsboro, North Carolina, a B-52 broke up midair as it suffered catastrophic loss of fuel. As the crew ejected, 2 nuclear bombs fell to the ground. In 2013, it was declassified that one of the nukes almost went off because 3 out of 4 triggering mechanisms had activated during the crash. On March 14, 1961, another B-52 ran out of fuel due to air crew's failure to refuel in time as they retired from their 24-hour-long mission. As the crew ejected and survived, 4 nuclear bombs crashed near Yuba City, California. The weapon's safety mechanisms worked, and none of the bombs went off. The next accident happened on January 10, 1964, near Barton, Maryland. It was discovered during a test that the stabilizer on the B-52s could snap off mid-flight. This particular B-52 landed back in one piece, along with this remarkable footage. But only 3 days later, the same thing happened on another BUF that was carrying 2 nuclear bombs. During a severe winter storm, the vertical stabilizer broke off and the airplane crashed. The nuclear bombs were later found relatively intact among the wreckage, with only 2 out of 5 crewmen making it out alive. But the next 2 accidents happened outside of the United States. On January 17, 1966, a B-52 collided with a KC-135 tanker during aerial refueling. As a result, three nuclear bombs fell down near Palomares in Spain. One bomb fell into the sea and was later recovered. The conventional explosives of the other two nuclear bombs that fell on land exploded, causing a radioactive contamination of 500 acres with radioactive plutonium. In the aftermath of the accident, the US government had to stop its practice of flying nuclear-armed bombers over Spain and engaged in a costly cleanup of the accident site. In total, over 3 million pounds of radioactive Spanish soil had to be dug up, placed in barrels, and shipped to the US. The final crash during Operation Chrome Dome happened on January 21, 1968, when a fire inside the cabin forced the B-52's crew to eject near Thule Air Base in Greenland. The crash caused the conventional weapons on board to go off, dispersing radioactive materials from four nuclear bombs. The following day, the US government ended the 24/7 Operation Chrome Dome due to inherent risks, expensive cleanups, and political scandals that followed. As was evident during Operation Chrome Dome and also a dozen more major and minor accidents, the B-52s had a lot of problems. The US Air Force spent decades sorting out all the issues by launching countless programs aimed at fixing buff. The originally installed J-57 engines proved unreliable, which caused the first fatal crash in 1956. The entire fleet was grounded. Shortly after resuming service, fuel and hydraulics issues grounded the fleet yet again. In the 1960s, it was discovered that when B-52s flew at low altitude, structural fatigue was accelerated by a factor of 8. Thus, a high-stress program was launched to address this problem. When the Air Force decided to store fuel in wings of B-52 models G and H, it resulted in 60% increase in stress, meaning the wings had to be redone as part of the ECP 1050 program. In 1966, longerons, avionics, and fuselage skin had to be replaced. All B-52s had to be reskinned again in 1977. An even bigger issue was ice buildup in the fuel system and numerous leaks in fuel tanks that caused multiple crashes. Worries about B-52 falling apart due to its multiple technical issues was a very real threat. The Air Force worried about the B-52s falling apart before they could even get a new bomber in place. But it wasn't just the plane. Buff was so heavy that ramps and taxiways deteriorated much faster than expected. By the time most of the technical issues related to the B-52 fleet were resolved, the advances in Soviet Union's air defenses, especially surface-to-air missiles or SAMs, and interceptors, had made Buff obsolete. They could no longer fly directly into Soviet Union's territory and drop gravity nuclear bombs. But this turned out to be very lucky for Buff. Even though XB-70 and B-1A were much faster and more capable bombers, they, too, were now vulnerable to Soviet air defenses. There was no point in pouring money into these programs anymore, so Valkyrie and B-1A were cancelled, and B-52s kept flying. The Pentagon instead poured money into intercontinental ballistic missiles, submarine-launched ballistic missiles, and cruise missiles with nuclear warheads, such as AGM-86, which could be launched far away from Soviet airspace. The second lucky development for the B-52 was the Vietnam War, during which they were converted into giant flying dump trucks raining conventional bombs on enemy positions. Specifically, Buff underwent modification Big Belly, which increased its capacity of 500-pound bombs from 27 to 84. The internal weapons bay allows for better fuel efficiency, because a full load of bombs under the wings will increase fuel consumption by 30%. Buff is capable of carrying up to 70,000 pounds of weapons and has a typical range of 8,800 miles without the need for aerial refueling. Its top speed is 650 miles per hour and a maximum altitude of 50,000 feet, although it never flies that high with its belly fully loaded. By 1966, B-52s were dropping 8,000 tons of bombs in South Vietnam every month. It was in Vietnam where B-52s earned a reputation of being a dreaded bearer of death and destruction. But it wasn't all smooth for Buff. During the Vietnam War, Americans officially lost 15 of them, although Vietnamese claimed they shot down at least 34. During the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan in the 90s and 2000s, Buff was equipped with precision-guided munitions that could be fired from outside of the enemy's anti-air defense systems. Alternatively, once the enemy's air defenses had been neutralized, Buff could perform a bombing run, as it happened during the Gulf War. In fact, one of the reasons for keeping B-52s around was using them in low-intensity conflicts where the enemy doesn't possess modern air defenses. Going back to the early 80s, things were not looking so good for the future of B-52s. The Advanced Technology Program, the very program that resulted in the B-2 Spirit stealth bomber, was secretly going full steam. Designed to penetrate dense air defenses due to its low radar cross-section, B-2 was America's ticket to fly into Soviet territory again. Goodbye, Buff, you'd think. But it would be almost two decades before the B-2 would enter service. This meant that B-52s were to remain in service and provide nuclear deterrence using the new AGM-86 cruise missiles that had just entered service. War Games suggested that Buffs equipped with nuclear cruise missiles would be a credible threat to the Soviets until 1985. But there was a problem. In the early 80s, it was estimated that if the B-2 fleet were to launch a cruise missile attack, only 75% of them would survive the Soviet defenses, and the survivability percentage kept decreasing as the Soviet technological advancements continued. So President Reagan resurrected the B-1 program as a long-range combat aircraft project. In essence, the B-1 Lancer became a stopgap bomber between the vulnerable B-52s and the future B-2 stealth bombers. While 100 new B-1 bombers were being built between 1983 and 1988, Soviets introduced new technologies: the SA-10 missile, the MiG-31 interceptor, and an airborne early warning aircraft. By the time the last B-1 rolled out of production, the US Air Force concluded that the B-1s were as vulnerable to the Soviets' air defenses as the B-52s. And yet, another lucky development happened that kept Buff alive. As a result of the collapse of the Soviet Union and the end of the Cold War, the Pentagon reduced the number of procured stealth B-2 bombers from 132 to just 21. This meant that there were not going to be enough B-1s and B-2s around to replace the B-52 capabilities. Moreover, as part of the Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty with Russia, the B-1s would no longer carry nuclear weapons. That left the nuclear role just to B-2s and B-52s. Great news for Buff, except that as part of that same treaty, 375 B-2s had to be destroyed as well. Many Buffs were cut into five pieces using a 13,000-pound steel blade dropped from a crane. By the time everything was signed and done, the United States was left with just under 100 B-52s. While ICBMs and SLBMs are primary systems for delivering nuclear weapons, Buff is still retained for nuclear missions, because it can be quickly launched in a crisis and quickly called back mid-flight if senior officials conclude that a presumed nuclear threat had been falsely identified. This is something that missiles cannot do, at least not yet. Roughly 40 B-52H bombers are currently assigned a deterrence role as part of the nuclear triad. 70 years later, Buffs are still kicking around. Even after a rocky start, they proved to be reliable. Now, they just work. All problems have been fixed. Maintenance has been worked out, so it makes sense to keep them around. In recent years, Buff's availability has been over 60% compared to B-1's 40% and B-2's 35%. B-52 costs about $70,000 per hour to fly, roughly half that of B-2, but a bit more expensive than B-1. Being a missile truck that launches missiles from far away means that speed and stealth is of lesser importance. new missiles that are currently in development can strike from thousands of miles away. This will transition B-52s to an exclusively over-the-horizon standoff missile-launching role with the help of AGM-183A ARRW hypersonic missiles and long-range standoff nuclear-armed air-launched cruise missiles. LRSO missiles can hit targets in excess of 1,500 miles away. The U.S. Air Force plans to procure at least 1,000 nuclear-armed missiles. The super-duper missile, AGM-183A, will employ a rocket booster that will launch it into the upper atmosphere at 5 times the speed of sound. Then, the unpowered glide vehicle will accelerate up to Mach 20 as it falls to the ground and strikes high-value targets using its kinetic energy. Buff has good bones. B-52H, the last variant produced, spent most of its service life on the ground, alert for nuclear operations, and so its airframe has many thousands of hours of service life left, but not its engines. The Pentagon is replacing 608 engines on 76 Buffs, as well as purchasing 42 as spares, at a total cost of $2.6 billion. The Rolls-Royce F-130 engines will replace the old Pratt & Whitney TF-33 engines that are approaching end of life. The Air Force is looking at 25% to 30% better fuel efficiency and as much as a 40% increase in range with these new engines. The new F-130 engines can operate for 30,000 hours or more, meaning that an engine installed in the late 2020s might still be running into the 2090s. The youngest B-52 currently in service rolled off the production line in 1962, but it wouldn't be fair to call it a 60-year-old plane. In many ways, Buff is younger than airplanes made in the 1980s and 90s. Every 4 years, Buffs spend a few months at the Tinker Air Force Base in Oklahoma, where the aircraft's panels are removed, everything is inspected and repaired as needed. They also get re-winged, re-skinned, and retailed every now and then, thanks to the abundance of spare parts in the boneyard. But Buffs get new upgrades too, be it new wiring, radios, sensors, and even a new radar. Internal weapons bay upgrade, completed in 2017, featured a 66% increase in weapons payload as a result of using digital and rotary launchers. An upgraded communication system called Connect allows the crew to collect real-time intelligence data for situational awareness and even retarget an in-flight missile. So Buff becomes a bomber plus an airborne command and control airplane. In 2018, the U.S. Air Force announced that 62 B-1s and 20 B-2 stealth bombers will be retired by the 2030s, while retaining B-52s along with at least 100 new B-21 Raiders. Buff is currently expected to stay in service well into the 2050s.